This is cryptosporidium. It's one of the parasites that had 3 million people in Sydney boiling their water. It lies dormant in a cocoon called an oocyst until it enters the body and then suddenly multiplies. A single viable oocyst can turn into a million parasites in 7 days, carpeting the walls of the intestine and feeding on nutrients. What follows is diarrhea, vomiting, high fever and dehydration. And there's no treatment.
When cryptosporidium was found in Milwaukee's water a few years ago, half the city got sick and 104 people died. But in Sydney, there was no epidemic, despite recording some of the highest contamination levels ever. So, was it a crisis or just an expensive false alarm?
Melbourne has Australia's cleanest water supply. And yet, during the panic in Sydney, Melbourne had the same rates of gastroenteritis as Sydney, even though tests show very few parasites in Melbourne's water, and even though a third of Sydneysiders ignore the boil water alerts.
There's no indication that drinking water often causes disease. Most cities throughout the world will have had this in their surface water supplies for years and years. What's new is the technology to detect it. So all of a sudden, we're able to find these things that we couldn't find before, and we're not sure what they mean.
We're living with the ghost of Milwaukee. If it could happen there, it could happen in other places. And that's what public health authorities are fearing, is that they don't want a repetition of that event where some 400,000 people became infected.
But yet we know next to nothing about that species or even that strain of cryptosporidium.
That's right. We really do have to understand the basic biology of the parasite to determine whether we're actually at risk or not.
When Peter O'Donoghue began studying cryptosporidium 20 years ago, it was an animal parasite. But in the 1980s, a species was found that could infect humans. Scientists now know that this parasite is very common. It's been found in up to a third of human fecal samples. Even more people carry antibodies for it.
The antibody levels in different communities have ranged from about 20% all the way up to 90%. And that means it's sort of a ubiquitous organism in the environment that most of us have been exposed to. Most epidemiological evidence tends to suggest that human-to-human transmission is the favoured route of transmission, animal-to-human to a lesser extent, and waterborne transmission appears to be a rarer occurrence.
The parasites that had Sydney in a panic are actually all around us, in everything we touch, the soil, animals, other people. Babies don't know about hygiene and their immune systems are immature, so they pick up the bugs easily. And they get sick easily. Once infected, an infant can pass millions of contagious oocysts a day. Not just cryptosporidium, but giardia too, the other microscopic parasite found in Sydney's water supply. You're more likely to pick up the parasites changing a nappy than anywhere else. And a lot of people do. It's estimated that more than 500,000 Australians are infected with these parasites every year. Half get sick, half don't. Some have a bellyache, some get diarrhea. Peter and Jackie Upcroft have been studying giardia from stool samples in Brisbane for the past 15 years.
Looks like this chromosome pattern.
They have found that it too is commonplace, especially among children.
Up to 12% of young children have been found to be positive for giardia, and that's in our own community. In other countries in the world, 300 million infections a year has been reported of giardia, and some 10,000 deaths associated with giardia.
One of the things that makes both parasites hard to study is their incredible variability. They're ancient. Giardia is one of the oldest life forms known. It's a shapeshifter, frequently changing its genetic makeup to avoid detection by the body. Therefore, we keep getting reinfected.
The example that we have here shows that isolates have changed since 1983, right through to 1993. We keep seeing different isolates. Chromosomes, for instance, of this size, you can see aren't present in this isolate. The variation is enormous. We have seen isolates in humans that would appear to be different species.
When the technology to test water came along in 1993, scientists found giardia there too, dormant in their cocoon-like cysts. And they found cryptosporidium, not just in Sydney, but in every city and town across Australia. The truth is, the parasites are in everybody's water supply. Even the cleanest natural water is teeming with bacteria, all sorts of parasites. Most cities use chlorine to kill these organisms, and it mostly works. But both Giardia and Cryptosporidium, encased in their protective shells, can survive this, so they have to be filtered out.
These sand filters are pretty good. They remove more than 99% of all of the parasites in the water. But when the parasites are so tiny and you're processing 3 billion litres a day, that little that gets through can be a lot, especially if the water upstream is heavily contaminated.
After 60 hours of filtering, this is what's left behind. Until 2 years ago, filtering wasn't even used in Sydney. It's still the case in many towns and cities across Australia. What gets through the filtering can be extraordinarily hard to detect.
When you get a sample, you end up with a pellet much like that. That's from 100 litres. That's all the particles in 100 litres of water.
At Macquarie University in Sydney, Mark Gauci and his team have developed an automated technique that rapidly identifies bugs in the water. Once the machine has sorted what looks like parasites, these have to be identified by sight.
You're the next slide, Phil.
But even if you find parasites in the water, it may not mean very much. 40% of people become ill with 100 ocysts of Cryptosporidium. Others can drink more than 1,000. In the case of Giardia, some people become ill with just 10 cysts. Others can swallow a million with no effect. Even if the parasites get through filtration, as they did in Sydney, it doesn't mean we will get sick.
We go back to, are they live or dead? If they're alive, are they infective to man or to animals? And even if they're infective to man, are they a virulent strain that's going to undergo explosive growth and probably cause disease? Or are they a low virulent strain which will just tick over at a low level and not cause much disease at all? So we don't know.
Giardia and Cryptosporidium are just two of an estimated 65,000 protozoan parasites so far identified. Each of these, in turn, have thousands of strains that may affect us differently. The truth is, we just don't know enough about them and about how they affect us. The answer may come from Melbourne, one of only six cities in the world with highly protected catchment areas. Melbourne set aside areas like this more than 100 years ago, wilderness catchment areas with billions of litres of pristine water to feed the city. No development is allowed anywhere near it. As a result, the water doesn't even have to be filtered. So, why does it have the same rates of gastroenteritis as Sydney?
Just make a fist, Kathleen.
To find out, Melbourne scientists are conducting a study of 600 homes, tracking the incidence of stomach upsets, vomiting, anything that might be a parasitic infection. Half the homes will have a real filter that keeps everything out. The other half will have a dummy filter. By comparing illness rates between the two, researchers will know whether water plays a part at all. Surprisingly, it's the first time in the world a study like this has been done.
And instead of getting obsessed about what you find in the water, we're actually measuring what's happening to the people. At the end of the water quality study, we'll be able to tell people whether the water is or is not causing any people disease. Therefore, we'll know, on the basis of evidence, whether we need to put $500 million into a filtration plant or whether that money would be better spent in other areas like hospital or roads.
In the meantime, scientists need more time to understand the parasites, because despite the grandiose claims and the screaming headlines, we're still at the very beginning of our understanding.
It's early days. We really do have to explore the genotyping and the genetic characterisation, but we have to do it coldly and calmly and make sure we get it right, because there are big decisions based on what we tell the water industry, whether to put in a plant or not, whether to throw out one plant and put in another. And we're talking millions, if not billions, of dollars worth of expenditure. So we scientists literally have to get it right before we force this huge economic burden on society. Thank you.